grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with all that are here and those that may be watching us later through our various platforms. We ask that those here, as we welcome you, might take a moment to sign our attendance registration folders that are at the ends of the rows of pews. A couple of announcements real quick. One is next Sunday we will be celebrating together the Lord's Supper using the little cups so that we prevent any kind of transmission of any disease. Also, the session will meet following worship next Sunday as well in the ladies' parlor. And just a quick reminder, don't forget the Wednesday devotionals that you will be able to find Wednesday morning as we continue to give little prequels to our sermon that's coming the following Sunday. And now may the Lord be with each and every one of you. Let us now call ourselves to worship with the call to worship that you will find in your bulletins this morning. Let we who live with faith in God proclaim.
Lord, you are my refuge and my fortress. My God, I will trust forever.
Let we who trust in the Lord know that the Holy Love surrounds us.
God's attention follows us throughout our days.
When we call out to the Lord,
we know that we are heard.
God is with us in every trial and temptation. Therefore, we will rejoice in the salvation of the Almighty. Amen. Let us bow in prayer together. Give us, O Lord, that purity of conscience which alone we can receive your inspirations unto us. Lord, our ears are dull, so that we cannot always hear your voice. Our eyes may be dim, so that we cannot always see the signs of your presence. You alone can quicken our hearing and purge our sight and cleanse and renew our hearts. Therefore, teach us to sit at your feet and to be silent, listening to hear your word. Amen. Let us continue worshiping God as we stand and sing together hymn 366, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Let us stand and sing.
Thank you.
during worship, we come before the Lord together as a community of faithful believers and to confess our sins publicly, first in the prayer of confession that we all pray together, but then turn the whispered confessions of our hearts to our God. Let us do so now as we pray the prayer of confession in your bulletin. We pour out our hearts before you, O God. You are our refuge and strength. Waves of doubt beat against us, weakening our faith. Tremors of tribulation shake our foundation. The winds of temptation drive us from you. We rely on ourselves when security and wisdom are needed. Quiet the storms of our souls. Remind us of Christ's great sacrifice on our behalf. Provide in him a haven of hope for our troubles and distracted lives. Hear us as we seek your mercy. Lord, you promise us grace when we come before you and pray and confess our missteps in life. And yet, it is hard enough for us as human beings to admit wrongs in our own lives instead of running away from them or seeking to cover them up or just simply forget them. And yet, our Lord knows our transgressions. And he can relieve our guilt and, yes, our running away from things that are unpleasant that we find within ourselves. He can cleanse our lives. He can lift the burdens of our sins and make our lives lighter as we seek to also forgive others. Once we receive the forgiveness and mercy of our Lord Christ. Therefore, I charge you to allow God's forgiveness to sink into your lives and then to share that forgiveness one with another in his name. Amen. Let us respond to this offer of God's grace to each and every one of us by affirming our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed, affirming together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. please be seated, and I would ask our children to please come forward at this time. Good morning. Can you say that a little louder? That's even, I won't press the issue. This morning I want to kind of see, have you ever been in a car going toward the beach and it keeps going and going and you want to say, how much further, Mommy and Daddy, how much further? Have you ever said that? You have. There are certain times in our lives that we want things now. We want them to be over, the trip to the beach on vacation, or maybe we're waiting for Christmas morning and we can't go to sleep because we want it now. Or we see an ice cream cone and say, first eat your dinner. No, I want it now. Have you ever felt that way? I see some nods, yes, but you know what? God tells us to be patient. Patient means we wait for the good things in life and we don't become discouraged. We don't yell. We don't throw fits. We wait calmly. It's especially true because when we pray to God, we want our prayers answered now. But God's time is not our time. And so God says, be patient, and the good things will come. Let's pray and thank Him that He's there for us all the time. If we're patient, we will get the things we want. Let us pray. Lord, we know that Your wisdom is greater than our own. And sometimes we don't even know what we want until we receive it or see it in the past. We thank You for always being there as the one that provides things for us and gifts for us. Be with us in these days to come. Amen. Thank You. Thank you. Lord, silently in prayer as the people of God in worship. I would call your attention to those that are mentioned on the back of your bulletin this morning. I would especially ask us to remember Don Lee and Beth Wright and their families, as Sarah has been received into the heavenly kingdom above. Also, let us praise God for the arrival of Eliana Chance. Eliana, it comes and was born to Haley and Chance and Andrew Bond. Let us ask God's blessing and strength to be with them. And also congratulations to grandparents Joel and Jessica Chance and great-grandparents Clark and Jeannie Hutton. Now let us take all of those that are on our hearts and minds, including those things that are happening in the world around us, to the footstool of our Lord and our God. Let us pray. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place before even the mountains' presence were formed. Your Spirit goes from generation to generation, from century to century, from millennia to millennia, because you are eternal. We have seen your will played out over these millennia. And yet, sometimes we are so confined by the moment that we allow the trials and tribulations that we experience or the threats that we face in the moment overcome our faith, challenge that you are even in existence, allow us to feel that we are in control. That it is all up to us. And therefore, instead of listening to your still small voice guiding, uplifting, and soothing and bringing peace to us, we allow the siren songs of the present draw us into the rocks of adversity. And once there, we blame you, not ourselves, because we need someone besides ourselves to find fault with in living this life. And yet, your grace and your love is so great that you await the opening of our eyes and ears to your truth. That you created us in your image. That your love is great enough for us to participate in and love each other, no matter the differences we may perceive. That we are your children, And even if we wander away from your truth, your arms, just like the father of the prodigal, are open, waiting for our return. Help us to see things through the eyes of generations and millennia instead of the moment. Help us to find your truth as the guardrails of our lives, as we have seen it come to life in Jesus Christ. We study the Lord Christ, and we hear his words in worship, and occasionally even read them in Scripture. And yet, for our contemporary lives, often they are dismissed as old words instead of powerful human and celestial truths given to us for our protection and the protection of your community, of your children. Help us, Lord, in our value system to value ourselves because we are your creation, but also to value the gifts you have given us to give others. As we walk through this world, may we be reminded that you are still in control of the future and can be of our lives if we but listen. However, we recognize that you have given us freedom, that you do not control us, you just love us. For this, we give you our thanksgiving and ask that your grace be showered upon us and that our eyes might be open, along with our mouths, with praise and thanksgiving. Therefore, hear us now as we come to you in the prayer that Christ taught us to pray, praying together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now continue our worship together as we turn in our hymnals to hymn 805 and sing together, Come Sing to God. Let us stand and sing. scripture lesson today comes to us from the Gospel of Luke. It entails a parable, but before the parable comes, there is an introduction. A little bit of information for this so that it might make a little more sense to you, that Pilate, before this passage was written, had raided the temple treasury and had used the money to build an aqueduct into Jerusalem. The people were angered by this looting of the temple and the taking of its funds. And so there was restlessness. So what Pilate did was he took his centurion guard, many of those soldiers, and dressed them as Galileans and sent them to the temple to make an example of those that were of rebellious nature. And he sent them with cudgels so that he might hit those that had come to the temple to give their guilt sacrifices in the court of the Gentiles. The soldiers got a little too enthusiastic, and many were killed on that day that had come to the temple for forgiveness and paying for their penance and sacrifice as was prescribed in the books of the Bible for a sin offering. The second is a reference to the temple or the tower in Siloam, which fell because many felt that it was an earthquake or it was poorly built, and it, in its falling, killed 18 people. 18 of the Jewish people who had helped construct this particular tower. And many started to point that it was God that did this. That's the context. Now hear the word of the Lord as we find it in Luke, followed by his parable. Now there were some present at the time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. Jesus answered those that had come to him, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish. Or those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish." Then Jesus told this parable. A man had a fig tree growing in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, "For 3 years now I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?" "Sir," the man replied, "leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit in the next year, fine. If not, then cut the vine down." word of the Lord.
Let
us pray. Gracious God, we come before you away from the maddening noise of the world that pushes and pulls us and tempts us in so many different ways that we become confounded, confused, angry, resentful in all of those things that the voices of choices come to us to tell us in the moment. But we are here in your sanctuary. And so let us be quiet and listen. The words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts might be uplifted and found acceptable in thy sight. Thou who art the Creator God and sustainer of all that is, and yet came to us in the human form of Jesus Christ, that we might know you personally as our Savior, as our brother, as our friend and constant companion in him. Amen. Yogi Berra was one of those that you could find a book on his sayings. They're one of those things that he would say that sounded so logical but seemed so contradictory at the same time. One of those that has become part of our vernacular is, it ain't over until it's over, which is a truism. We use it a lot in sports, as Berra was one of those sports stars. But it is also true in life. It ain't over until it's over. And so we are not released to do whatever we want at any time. And we have the time to do it while we are still alive, to make our lives better, happier, more grounded in faith. A lot of people read these particular passages, by the way, and they think about, well, he's talking about repent before you go to hell. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about a self-awareness that understands that what these people are living through and seeing is that they are allowing themselves to be caught up in the situations that they see around them and make judgments on other people. He was also speaking to people that were coming to him before he went to Jerusalem, who were warning him of Pilate and his bloodthirsty nature and his seeking of power, as well as Herod, who was there. And so there is several levels to this particular passage and parable. The one level is to deal with patience, to wait for the Lord. How many times have we heard that in the Psalms and in the Scriptures? Wait for the Lord. I say wait for the Lord in Psalm 39. But we are an immediate gratification people. We don't want to wait for anybody. We only want to wait for the Lord. We have a hard time, as I said in my children's sermon, to wait for the things that we want. Look at Amazon. Look at the things that we have today that feed our immediate gratification. At the same time they feed that, They feed impatience. They feed immediate view, the short-term view, instead of understanding that we live in the age of the Lord, which is eternal. And therefore, we become very reactive to the stimuluses that are around us. Some of you may remember when we used to repair things. Remember that? Instead of throwing them away, oh, this is too, just get a new one. Instead, there was a certain satisfaction in sitting down and saying, I'm going to figure out how this thing works and make it work. We don't do that very much anymore. Very few people you can find to actually fix things. You call them on the phone and say, we don't fix those anymore. It's better to throw it away. It's cheaper to throw it away. In some ways, that could be applied to faith. Cheaper to not have to go with it. It's cheaper on us, it's less demanding on us not to have to live through it. Just to kind of be present, but not actually engage the faith and the ways we live life. That's too much. One of the themes of this particular parable that comes in terms of repentance is that we repent being so impatient and not waiting on the Lord, but only thinking about ourselves and thinking we're in control. The parable's interesting. Since most of us have not been to Palestine, we are not aware of how precious land is there. Fig trees were one of the greatest of all of the income producers in that area. And so once you planted the fig tree, you gave it 3 years to produce fruit because that was the norm. It would take about 3 years to produce good fruit. And so the master's going through and he sees this barren tree that could be uprooted and a productive tree put down. But the vine dresser, the one who takes care of the vines, it comes to him and says, give it one more year. Give it one more year. And I will give it special attention. I will fertilize it. I will watch it. I will care for it. And if in 1 year, notice this is not eternal. It's not like saying, well, forever, I will do this until it produces fruit. There is a time limit, as there is for all of us in life, to do what God has set for us to do. So give us this time to nurture this tree, and if in 1 year it is not producing fruit, then you can replace it with another. The implication here is twofold. One is the immediate implication that Jesus is using this to speak to some of these other things that are going on with Pilate and other people that are becoming very, very entrenched in the politics of the day and in the things and suffering a great deal. And it says suffering and repentance doesn't mean a change of life, that it just simply means going on and doing the things we've always been doing and ignoring the things that are a little unpleasant. The first lesson is that we don't reject people immediately.
our judgment is for those 3 years. We give them so much time and then we repent. Jesus is saying, as the vine dresser, no. No. Give me some time with this person. Give me this some time with this relative, with this friend that you've rejected, with this child that has gone his own way. Give me some time. Keep them in your heart, and let me work with them spiritually. And if it doesn't work out, then. The other one is that Jesus was on, he's predicting what he will do. For 3 years, many people will not see who Jesus is or what he has come to do. And then he is crucified after those 3 years, just the same lifespan of the fig tree. But once he goes into the grave and is risen again, all of a sudden he bears the fruit that spreads across the Mediterranean and then Europe and then the world. And the world is changed because of that sowing of that seed in that extra year in which his disciples see the truth. It's a very complex thing. We think of the scriptures all too often as a narrative of simplistic stories that are bound together absent-mindedly almost. And yet, they are the truth of how Jesus works through us, you and I, to achieve his purposes if we are patient. For it ain't over until it's over. Father, forgive us for all our doubts, worries, and fears. Forgive us for our impatience as we wait for you. Forgive us for questioning the story you have written for us and dismissing it out of hand. We believe, Lord. But we need help in our unbelief. Help us to remember that it is good to wait for you. Grant us the joy that comes from seeking and knowing you. And fill our hearts with your love, with your peace, and most of all, with the acceptance. Not only of you, but of one another as children of the Most High. Amen. Let us conclude our worship as we turn in our hymnals to hymn 444. Forgive our sins as we forgive. Let us stand and sing. Thank you. beloved, go in peace. Go in peace, treating one another as you would like to be treated, accepting the call of the Spirit unto you and to your life, and to accept His grace and His peace into your heart this day, and in all the days ahead.